of the world will come to India. Now, what I have seen is I travel at least 10 days in a month. When I'm at airport, it says 30 minutes free internet. I have to find where is the access point in the place like airport where top people are there.
And this is Delhi airport.
Which does not work. Whether it's Delhi, Mumbai, anywhere. And they say that 30 minutes is free. It takes 30 minutes to log in actually.
You are right.
Two, 3 years down the line, yes, everybody is waiting. And maybe the situation, we are seeing the improving. But today's scenario, we have to think that, but today's scenario, what we can do the best out of it.
I can just assure you, in 3 years from now, if you don't have a physical connectivity of to Badrinath, you will be definitely connected to
in places like Poplar, we have connectivity through satellite only, but it hardly works. It's so expensive. A guest pays me a rent of 2,500 rupees and he expects internet free over satellite.
Yeah, please. Last observation and then we move on to the next.
Yeah, I think in some ways the cloud strategy is today where a digital strategy was some years ago. I mean, when there was a lot of disparate stuff, people were looking at social media separately, and I think now it has become very integrated for many companies. For some it happens automatically, like maybe e-commerce and things like that, where the central strategy is the cloud. But I think we're still some way away from cloud becoming a topic on the CXO team. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's happening quite so soon.
And obviously, fortunately or unfortunately, that responsibility falls on the CIO to have that as the center theme for the CXOs. Yeah, any quick...
Just add one quick point.
Yes, I think I'll give the chance to him first. Yeah, can we have the mic for him? Sorry,
we
come to you. Just a minute.
Hi, this is Vishal here, and I represent a company called Sovereign Health. We have rehab centers based out of US locations. So it's a very challenging job for us to bring cloud technologies to our centers, because we have doctors and nurses who are not very IT savvy. So they only send a note via scanned PDF. Kind of a stuff where we'll introduce signature pads and leverage cloud technology, SharePoint, online Office 365 entire model, which will help us to minimize the timeline from like 24 hours deadline to about 20 minutes. So which is a very value add in terms of entire organization to decrease down the man hours, as well as the response time is very high.
Yeah,
we are very much beneficial about that.
From this, yeah. Okay, yeah, he wanted to make a point. Can we have the mic for him here, please?
The way mobile revolution has happened in India, we are currently now 950 million plus connections. So, of course, we are going in the positive direction. And technology is changing our life. I just want to come to that hotel business. I used to stay a lot of big hotels in whenever I am traveling all over the world. I get a message from hotels. This is your birthday. Congratulations. This is your marriage anniversary. So hotels now sending these kind of messages to my mobiles. Mm-hmm. And also, my son was left the cricket bat in one of the hotel in Leela. And they send me a message saying that your cricket bat is safe. Whenever you come back, please collect it. So that means technology is really helping in hotel business also.
So I'm sure you know that I think Marriott announced last quarter that they are no longer a hospitality company, they are a technology company.
Yeah. Yeah, just like a lot of these firms in the taxi companies say we are a IT company and basically offering travel services. Yeah. So let me. I think we are really running out of time. So let me come to the last point before we wrap up and have a presentation. We have also one of the things that we wanted to discuss today is that how is cloud, obviously besides the commercial benefits and besides the fact that it really lets you focus on your core activities, and IT is getting so complex and complicated, so you are sort of relieved from that a bit. So how is it also helping in terms of productivity? Is it also helping in terms of innovation? Are there some experiences that you can share, and then we can give the audience also a chance to share? So are there examples where cloud has helped you to be more productive, new ideas, to be more innovative. Yeah, you could start.
So, as a role of like in the CXO role and when you are CIO or CTO, it is very important for you that how much focus of your resources would be on your core work and what is the subsidiary work. This is like a distinction has to be made. How much allocation of time, how much allocation of money, and what is the ROI on that? That is very important. So with changing needs, one desire is that if I can get most of the things as service, service oriented environment, then I may focus on my core business more. So YepMe, it is not an IT company. But we don't have a store, we sell online, right? So the point, what I am trying to make, company's main focus is to sell apparels, to like brand itself as a fashion label, right? But that is not their core objective. IT is not their core objective, right? IT is only at the serving end. I cannot do anything on my own. All other departments, whether it is merchandising, whether it is marketing, whether it is customer care, or whether it is back office operations, they are my customers, as well as the entire community of people who are logging on, they are my customers. So I cannot do anything on my own. I am either doing by the feedback of customer base or them. So being a software engineer at the core, I never wanted that I should put attention on those things, that when things will go down, how I will scale, or all those things. So this cloud technology has actually helped me to save my energy and put on my core area of software development rather than going into
details, more of administrative kind of.
In the administrative. But as the responsibility of CIO or CTO, that core responsibility still lies with me. Even if the network is going down, what the contingency you have made, I am unanswerable for.
Yeah.
So cloud is helping me to achieve that thing by not putting that much time as I used to put on.
Any other experiences?
So how the cloud has helped is the, one is that our own team has been very lean. Need not to bear too much of resources with us. Most importantly, our time is free. So it is not very difficult to understand the business, discuss the business plan, at the same time focus on what is happening on infra, whether I should commit or not commit, right? Whether I will be able to make this in within this time or not this time. So if somebody is discussing some idea or some business case and they want IT to commit, I feel we are very comfortable to committing, okay, this will happen. And earlier we used to say, okay, we'll come back to you. Right, we'll discuss, we'll submit a proposal. Here at least we have that confidence. Okay, it will happen very quickly. You make your plan and we know by the time you execute your plan, we are ready.
Yeah, any other experiences on innovation and productivity?
Let's share a small example. Since I represent a law firm, there is a high-stakes matter which is coming up in the court. From our side also, we have to hire a senior counsel. And from the opponent side also, the opponent has to hire a senior counsel. The judge will give just 2 minutes to check the calendar on which would be the next date. So the opponent counsel has to also ask the senior counsel. And from our side also, we have to ask the senior counsel and the lawyer who is representing. The senior counsel might be a big person like a principal or somebody like that. He has got various engagements. He cannot share his own calendar. So we had built an application, a calendar sharing application, in which we give them the freedom of allocating which dates they are free. The same way for our senior counsel. And it gives us a result. These are the best dates which are available. This is the time slot which can be used. Now it is so fast, and it gives us the option of selecting first, second, and third, the priority. And then everybody agrees in just one phone call that yes, we agree for this date. This is the reason why much of the cases have become progressed so fast in the last couple of months for us.
Yeah, I think that's a very interesting example, because getting the common time for the opponent as well as the first party and the judge is often a very, very complicated affair, and a lot of up and down happens for the date, the hearing date. Yeah.
I have a suggestion. We can put an app onto the public domain for that.
have done something at Sarova, what we have done is we have a lot of training manuals with us. And we want to make sure that it is safe also, that an employee leaves, he does not open his own new hotel company by using all the manuals.
Mm-hmm.
And training is required because, you know, we are using all the manpower to IT, ITS and other BPOs.
Yeah.
So what we have done is we have put all the manuals of housekeeping, front office, different sales departments, how to negotiate better, all those manuals on cloud.
Okay.
And no one can print those. They cannot download it. And we also know that who has logged in to which manual, like,
yeah,
what is the duration,
yeah,
like.
Yeah, yeah.
So this is what we have done.
How much self-training is an employee doing? Yeah.
Exactly. And after that, you know, we also, once you someone has read, say, 5 pages, then automatically questions comes from those 5 pages,
right,
and he has to give
answers to those
answers to those, so that we know that how much he has,
yeah,
really gained from that.
That's interesting, yeah.
As I mentioned right at the beginning, our own experience has been project-based in one of our group companies, and this is a spend analysis project which was talking about, which the you know, which the company took up. So it was basically an analytics project, which required huge quantities of data to be analyzed, and it would have been quite difficult to, I mean, to kind of do it, you know, without the cloud. So that was a you know, specific experience that we had, and I think it has opened up a new revenue stream for us.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. Yeah. Any other quick comments? Any other experiences? Anything else that you would like to? Any remarks? Yeah. Yeah. Could I have the mic?
Hello. Good evening, everyone. I'm Nikhil Mathur. I'm a solution specialist at Microsoft. So, this discussion has been very, very good. And I must say, I thought I'll take just 5 minutes to give you the perspective we have around cloud, right? So the way you know, Microsoft sees cloud, of course, it's a disruptive industry trend, right? We strongly believe that it can help businesses in innovating their business. And maybe I can share with you some examples on how we've been doing it for some of our companies, how we've helped some of our companies here as well. Well, fundamentally, why would somebody move to the cloud? One, speed, agility of operations. Just think of how much time would it take for you to get an application live, making a plan, buying a server, it coming, it, you know, getting deployed, you putting an application on top of it, going live, it can take time, right? In businesses, you really have to be agile. So the time gets cut significantly. When you're talking about cloud, you could spin a VM in a matter of minutes.
So the,
and
go,
get going.
The go-to-market time or the
response time completely changes. I think another point two, which I think has been raised as well, around elasticity. If you have to provision resources and scale up and down dynamically, can you really do it in a traditional model? I mean, e-commerce, of course, is one industry where you would have loads increasing, but it's applicable across, right? Why would you really, you know, want to provision hardware and then get stuck because the performance is an issue? You could dynamically provision resources. Scalability is a major issue. You can't get it otherwise, right? Of course, third is we're talking about CapEx versus OpEx. Cloud is about pay-as-you-go, right? See, a lot of times when we make an investment, we have a server which lies idle for such a long time. In cloud, one of the advantages you immediately get is you would pay for what you consume it, right? For other time, you could have your services shut down and you would not be charged at all for it. So in terms of return on investment, in terms of you know, ensuring that you don't have a capital expenditure upfront, it makes a lot of sense to move to cloud, right? And even in the most difficult of industries, like I just heard BFSI, right? Or for that matter, government, right? Which have their, which have issues around putting the data out of the country. Even government of India now, for a lot of these applications, they want to provide citizen-centric services and they want those services to reach the end citizens faster. They are looking at cloud, right? And again, BFSI, I understand IRD has those regulations. And like, and what Microsoft has also recently done is we are making sure there is data center available for Azure in India. So by the end of this year, we'll have data center in 3 locations in India, and we should be able to help our customers there. But think of, you know, how you can really innovate using cloud. I mean, just to give you an example, look at automotive industry, right? For an industry which, you know, you would want to come up with smarter connected vehicles, we're talking about vehicles now which will have sensor devices. Those sensor devices will be relaying information to the cloud. Cloud, there'll be some machine learning algorithms which will help the company service the customer at the right time. So it's about making sure that end-to-end life cycle of the customer gets taken care of. This concept is called Internet of Things. I'm sure a lot of you would have heard of it as well, right? It's coming up in a big way. I just heard Quattro saying that, you know, big data analysis, right? See, it's all about ensuring that you are able to, you know, generate revenue, get cut down on your cost. That's where you get profitability, right? So some of the big data analysis, even for that matter in e-commerce, a lot of industries, if you want to get data from multiple sources, structured, unstructured, to be able to do that computation will require huge investments upfront. I mean, you can't possibly think of having those kind of investments. On the other hand, you just go to the cloud. There are all these services available for you to use, consume, and there you go. You get immediate insights for the marketing division. They are able to figure out customer buying patterns. Whatever intelligence you're looking at, you could look at that, right? And a simple scenario is, a lot of you, when, you know, as CIOs, you'll be provisioning for test dev environments. Why provision test dev environments on premise? I mean, you could just look at, so much time would be taken for the servers to come, for you to test things, and then what happens to those servers? Just provision VMs on the cloud, do testing, and there you go. Once you're done with it, that's all you pay for, right? Another thing could be storage. You have so much tape drives, file shares, which are there on premise. Why do you want to store so much data, invest so much on your, you know, storage cost? Might as well push this data on the cloud. You could have the warm, hot data if you want, hot data on premise, and maybe the cold, inactive data on the cloud, or even otherwise, right? Another example which I could, you know, so again, when we look at cloud, I heard, you know, some companies are using Office 365, so that's more like software as a service, where you don't have to worry about anything. You know, vendors will take care of, so in this case, Microsoft will take care of everything end-to-end, data, application, everything. But an immediate first step to move to the cloud, of course, is if you want to lift and shift and move some of your applications, the way to go about doing it is infrastructure as a service, right? You can have those same VMs provisioned and you could take them to the cloud, and that's like a no-brainer. You know, whatever's running here, immediately moves there, and later on, you could have that running as a platform as a service. That's where you really leverage the platform and cloud advantages, wherein, you know, and for definitely for some of the new applications which are coming, you should, in your planning phase, think of using cloud and the platform as a service offering, which some of these vendors have, right? And again, you would see for yourself the kind of advantages you get in terms of cost, in terms of flexibility, scalability, which surely traditional environments cannot cater to. So I thought,
yeah,
you know,
yeah, I think that's I think the in a nutshell what you are saying, and that's I think the beauty of cloud and the uniqueness of cloud is that it completely gives you a new way at looking at technology, and that it's basically pay as you go. Obviously, I think all of them also talked about the kind of effort that they have in terms of convincing the board and the CEO and the CXO. So I think closer cooperation is required between the technology specialists and the users. Thanks a lot. Thank you so much.
And just a last remark here.
Yeah.
You know, I heard a lot around security and some of the challenges there. So all the companies, all the vendors, right? We are ensuring that, you know, you have the world class data center infrastructure. ISO standards are being compliant. So security is very critical, because none of the services will be online if you do that. In terms of latency, our data center in India, which is coming in, will make sure that the latency issues are not there. So a lot of reasons for you to look at cloud, and yeah, hopefully Microsoft cloud.
Yeah. Okay, so thanks a lot. I think this is one area, one subject where we can go on discussing and talking. And as I said in the beginning, that this is not the right time to really deep dive into all the issues that we discussed. But I think it's given us a lot of food for thought subsequently. And I'm sure we will have more such gatherings, and I hope that we are able to put together a platform where we don't get just the technologists, but also get the CXOs to come and really talk to each other and really understand what the cloud is all about. Thank you so much. Before I hand over the podium to our next speaker, can I invite Ashish from PC Solutions and Anubhuti from Microsoft to give a small token of appreciation from Data Quest to our distinguished panelist here. Before we break for cocktails and dinner, I would like to invite on the dais Mr. Deepak Chawla. He is the GM with PC Solutions, and he is going to talk about the latest technologies which you can use for transforming your business processes. Can I invite Deepak on the stage, please?
Session where we basically discussed a lot of aspects around cloud, and I would really like to thank DataQuest for actually giving us a platform to discuss in this kind of a forum where ideas, challenges, and the solutions are discussed at one go within the industry peers. My name is Deepak Chawla, and I work as a general manager for PC Solutions. I'm part of the projects and consulting team within PC Solutions, and just to give you a very, very quick brief background of we as an organization as to what we think of the cloud and how we adapted it. So we started our cloud journey, I would say around 5 years back, right? It was like 2008 and 9 when we actually started cloud, when this cloud term itself was not understood properly, right? So virtualization was misconceived as a cloud. And then there was a lot of talk about what is platform as a service, infrastructure as a service, and then software as a service. So that's the time when we actually started getting into it. We started off by taking some of the workloads to the cloud which were available, and then we slowly moved into platform as a service. A lot of POCs were done at that point in time, because as we discussed during the forum, I mean, so a lot of reservations about that. Today, probably we are living in a different world, a lot of things are getting into it. But at that point in time, we had a tough time actually convincing customers. Having said that, we take pride in actually sharing that even in 2010 and 11, we actually moved some of our customers' workload into cloud. Okay, so that was the time when we started in. And over a period of time, I think from a cloud standpoint, we would have roughly moved 3 lakh, around 300,000 seats. 3 lakh plus seats on Office 365, which is particularly means that from a messaging point of view, pretty much 3 lakh seats or mailboxes have been migrated to cloud from various aspects, on-prem, one version, one technology, another one, right? So that's something. From an application standpoint, again, we would have closely moved more than 200 odd applications. When I'm saying applications, some of those are simpler, some are complex, and some are real line of business application also. We have moved to various forms of cloud. Most of them have been actually platform as a service. So that's where we have been working on cloud. We have helped a lot of customers move to the cloud. I heard some of the comments where a lot of CIOs were mentioning that we'll have to learn it the hard way, right? We'll have to experience it ourselves and then probably move ahead. I would have a little different opinion. I mean, we can actually partner you. We can be a consultant to you, where we can share those kind of experiences what we have been facing for last 5 years, and that too again spread across industries, that too spread across various technology workloads, different applications, and different flavors of cloud. Right. So, I would say yes, some of those things are learned hard way, but again, there is no point reinventing the wheel all again. If we have some kind of a knowledge base available, let's try and utilize those things. That's where I would say, you know, probably that could be one of a step where we can actually collaborate together and we work as a partner. We go and co-create some of those applications, some of the co-creation of those kind of environments for you, right? Switching back to the agenda, what I'm going to talk about today is, and this again, a small extension of the discussions what we have been having. It's just that I have actually put some kind of a technology perspective to the whole discussion. We heard Nikhil just a few minutes back about what Microsoft thinks of the cloud, right? We being a solution partner of Microsoft, we also adopted Microsoft Azure and Office 365 as one of our foregoing cloud service offering, right? And I'm going to largely talk about that as to what are the kind of challenges which probably some of the panelists were discussing, and how does Microsoft Azure actually fills in. Few of the things Nikhil touched about, I will just quickly go through those. But to start with, why consider the cloud is, as we were discussing, these are the three aspects, and these are pretty much standard across globe, across industries, right? Why we need cloud is speed, scale, and economies. I mean, these are the three, four gone basic reason as to why should we consider cloud. I won't spend much time because we just had a discussion about it, but some of those key challenges, although having said this, we understand, we all understand that speed is the key, we all understand scalability is actually today need of the hour. Economics has been at the forefront all along, right from the traditional way of doing the business until today. But what are the kind of challenges would any CIO would today think of when thinking of cloud? Some of the challenges we discussed. But apart from that, I thought these are a couple of other means also. I mean, one of the key aspects is I have already made a huge IT investments over the period of time. If I'm not a startup, if I'm a startup, this kind of decision actually helped me. These are not points for me. But a lot of traditional organizations, they already have an IT setup. So what do I do with those kind of investments which I already have if I move to cloud, right? The second point is I have a heterogeneous environment with me. I mean, I'm not a single vendor shop, whereas the customer or the providers may provide me one kind of solutions, but then what will happen to my other pieces of it, right? I have an Oracle, I have a SQL Server, I have a different OS type of OS available with me, and my apps run on different type of platform. What do I do with that? Can I move all those workloads together at one single platform, right? Rather than looking at different providers, because if I am again looking at different providers, I'm actually not serving my or the pain which I was having. Lastly, security and compliance. So we have discussed at length about this. Now, essentially, if you see what does a corporate or an enterprise needs, they need integration, they need heterogeneity, and they need security. When I say integration means, there should be a platform which can actually help me integrate some of my on-prem stuff to my cloud stuff, right? It should not be that if I'm 100% on cloud or if I'm 100% on-prem, I need something where I can have a balance maybe to begin with, to start with. As Yepmi has actually moved everything pretty much to the cloud, probably that's gonna be the path I would like to follow, right? If I see benefits.
Just to add to it, we are still hybrid because our PC is fully cloud.
Okay,
the
DR.
And DR is completely on the dedicated.
Perfect.
And we can switch between them in a case of earthquake or something total disaster in less than 3 days.
Great. So that's something. Probably your DR is on-prem, which is
no,
your own data center?
It's again in a data center, but everything is on dedicated service.
Okay.
That is not cloud.
Okay. And some of, we have seen some of our customers where they have a DC at one cloud and a DR at another cloud. Right, so they take benefits and they have chosen different zones, and those zones redundancy etc. have been planned in such a way that if something goes wrong in one continent itself, the other DR piece is up and running. So those are the kind of things which have been done at some of the customers. We also have helped them design in such a way. Right, heterogeneity means I have a heterogeneous environment, and how do I fill those things? What does Windows Azure, which largely I'm going to talk about in next 10-15 minutes, is? So fundamentally, Azure provides me those kind of integration, right? When I say integration means, you have one single platform where you can actually connect back to your on-prem pieces, because Microsoft as a provider has been giving me all these. So my identity, which most of the organization today runs, they still run Active Directory as their identity authentication mechanism. Right, today you have cloud, you can actually hook into the same identity can be used for accessing your application which are running out of cloud. So you don't need a different set of authentication mechanism running out of for your application, so to say. So you have Active Directory which is on-prem, you have application which are running on cloud, so you have a connectivity available, right? So that's the kind of thing. So and then you have a lot of data platform. I'll talk in subsequent slide as to what does that mean, what are the kind of different services that are provided by Microsoft Azure. The second piece, I'm talking about heterogeneity. So Azure today, is, by the name of it, it's always Microsoft symbolizes with, and the first thing which hits us is, okay, for Windows, we all understand they will support, but what will happen to my other workloads? Right? What will happen to my Linux pieces? What will happen to my Oracle pieces, right? What will happen to my other Python, Ruby, Java kind of an apps? So the Azure as a platform today provides 100% compatibility to all these kind of workloads. So much so that Oracle on Azure is today supported, in fact, by Oracle themselves. Right, so it's no more only for database. If it's not only that you have to move everything to SQL Server only because it's a Microsoft cloud. If you are running Oracle, you can actually start using Azure also because it's supported both by Microsoft as well as Oracle. Right, so that's the kind of heterogeneous environment we're talking about. We're talking about Linux. So you have Linux VMs available as an out-of-box kind of a template. So you can run your Linux workloads also straight out of Azure. And these are all supported by the similar kind of SLAs, the way it is for any of the Windows or SQL kind of workloads, right? From a security standpoint, I know there are a lot of certification pieces being discussed. So obviously, we have those kind of certifications applied on the data center are fully certified on ISO pieces and other things. Apart from that, you also have some kind of audits. So you have audit, ELB audits, and then you have dollar-based SLAs, right? That's one aspect of actually looking at when we talk about security, but security is not just about these security compliances or doing these audits. It's also more to do with the trust which you have on your provider.
Yeah.
You
could see ISO 27001 standards, there are 136 controls. But those controls are designed in the traditional manner. It's not designed on the cloud scenarios taken into account. How
will
you implement those standards in
the
cloud scenario?
In ISO, sorry, I would like to answer this. 27001 has come out in 2013, which is the data storage addressing the cloud needs. And that's the reason Microsoft has also adopted that. In fact, they have announced that by, I think so, this year.
They
all old ISO certification will expire and they need to upgrade to 2013.
But even if that 2013, many of the controls are not applicable to cloud.
Yeah, correct. There are not many applicable, but as you rightly said on that day, just now, about the CSA. The CSA is Cloud Security Alliance. There are many things coming up. Which
so
is
you are
getting,
matching those?
Yeah, they are coming up in the 2030 certification.
The CSA has a much broader controls.
Yeah, much broader control, and I think so, over the period of time, as it's getting mature,
and the other piece which is again there as part of security compliance, we all sort of are a little worried about. But when we actually, again, it's the same case that when we have our own data center, what is the kind of security mechanism we have deployed? It's just that we have some kind of a comfort that, okay, the data is lying within my data center, so I am a little relaxed against if something is actually in the cloud. For Azure, there are several layer kind of security mechanism which are built in, which probably in our local data center, we generally do not go beyond two layer or three layers. It's a normal firewall and couple of other mechanism which we build in, but over here it is seven layer. But more than that, what I was talking about is as part of security, there has to be a trust factor, right? There has to be a trust factor with the provider itself, what is the kind of services they are offering. Right? So from a relationship standpoint, it's like, You can count on your existing relationship. You don't have to really build a new relationship if you are already on Microsoft. So it supports your existing enterprise agreements. You are on 24/7 support kind of a thing. All those things are pretty much straight away available to you. So if you are using Microsoft products, you are in relationship. It makes all the more sense to actually move to cloud also in a seamless way. The third piece is experience. So we all understand with being a Microsoft. So they have been actually, they started providing the so-called cloud services right from their Hotmail and Bing days. So it's not that something new which is coming up, right? So they have been providing, and those have been all consumer facing. Today also all the service pack, hot fixes, these are all cloud initiatives, nothing else. Right? So they understand. They understand that how these things actually happen over public cloud or for cloud. So to summarize, this is what Windows Azure today delivers. It delivers the integration, heterogeneity, and the security aspects, right? Typically talking about the data center which we have been talking largely, it's like these are some of the global data centers which are today available. As Nikhil mentioned, we have three data centers coming up in India within this year. In fact, some of those, they're going to start some promo activities where they'll do some kind of the eval and trial version for some of the customers because starting July. So you can have a test and feel of the data center being available in India itself.
In fact, 6 months ago from now, they've started training their partners so that, you know, that when they come up with a data center, the partners are ready to support the India-based offers. That's how the thing
is. Yeah. So some of you might already be using Azure from, and you would have been using some other different data center. It could be Asia-Pac or it could be North American data centers. So when once this things come, probably that could be, you may actually see if your workload is largely from India-centric, you may still want to actually take some of those workloads from those data centers to Indian data centers, right? So that's the exercise which we as a partner have already got trained on. So we know how to do that seamlessly without affecting any kind of large downtime species. So that's the training which we have already undergone, that's what I'm saying. Both in terms of Azure workloads as well as Office 365 pieces. See, some of the messaging or mailing mailboxes which you are currently running are largely running from, not from India data center because it's not there. So you may want to actually bring some of those workloads here to cut down the latency and the and to increase and improve your performance. In terms of percentage improvement, I wouldn't be able to comment as at this point in time because honestly, I do not have that kind of a data available with me right now. But as part of the exercise which we are going to do, as part of taking some of those customers there, and then we will have that kind of a real data being available to us when we do some kind of a real data analysis onto the same kind of workload being accessed from, let's say, Southeast Asia or from American data centers and then against this. So those kind of data probably will come in due course of time. As of now, what is the expectation if you are asking? I honestly do not have data. I'll probably check and get
it's
back.
Important for the user experience. If I have an application where I press the button and I go, it's just not working. So that's the experience user pass it on to the IT.
Right.
Or it doesn't work. So this is very important. So you see, I spend or I save, doesn't matter.
That's probably one of the reasons which
in the month of July it is being announced to partners that the details will start coming. In July, if you will share more specific data around. But definitely what our experience just to put business room is at least 30% improvement.
Is it also possible that India specific user will access India data center from Office 365
point of view? Sir, and mainly the configuration, right? So as you rightly said that if you're already using Azure and you would like to use the data center of India, then there are configurations and other things to be done. And once it is done, then it's like today also when you configure the Azure cluster and other clusters, you configure at the beginning of the workload that how you want to distribute the load. That's a kind of flexibility to the customer being provided.
But within that's going to be, to answer specifically your question on the Office 365 piece, that if you are saying that these are my set of users, probably they should hit my India data center,
yeah,
whereas these are the set of
yeah.
users, or they're going to hit my other data center because they're coming from. So as of now, the exact clarity is not there, but the discussion what we have it is, yes, this will be possible by actually doing some kind of a configuration pieces, right? Then, but it's going to be like static rule which will have to be defined. For a set of users, India, for a set of users, probably
in
the
case of mailboxes.
Yeah.
In the case of apps, it is different.
Yeah.
That's
on Azure. Yeah. So for app, it's already there. So you can still configure through a CDN and other pieces, right? You can still enable and divert your traffic rule using traffic manager and other pieces. So those features are already available.
And yeah. In fact, in this case, a feature called show routing plays more importance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is possible that a data center which is just few kilometers from here, you may not even play a movie from there, and the same movie which is hosted somewhere in San Francisco will run faster on YouTube.
Absolutely.
Because how the bandwidth is being consumed and what is the availability of it.
However, just to address this movie example, I'm saying that the PC solution is a streaming app for Azure, which runs on all the devices. And when you stream it, depending upon the device it detects, it offers you a seamless play.
In fact, when you say in Skype, hello, how are you? You don't know that hello packet may be going through Japan, mm-hmm. and the U is routing through Singapore, but that is they are collecting together at there. So that is all network layer.
And there was one question came in that from Salim Arvind that why don't you share that application to the marketplace? Right? The marketplace is also gaining a momentum. Lot of apps which we have created as a PC solution is a provider are available on marketplace. Similarly, other providers are also doing. So there's an Azure marketplace. Use those apps ready to use, and that is going to grow.
Right. So this is a quick snapshot of what is the local currency and stuff like that, right? Now, what are the different offerings which Azure has been providing, and what are the few things which just got added to the overall offering piece of it? So the whole gamut of services has been divided into three different layers: the app services, the data services, and the infrastructure services. Now, every service in itself, if I start explaining, probably will need minimum one hour. So in the interest of time, I'll just quickly go through a few. I understand that we're running a little short of time. But a quick run through is some of those important pieces are like, you see, cloud services. The cloud services is nothing but a platform as a service where you have a platform available, and over that you can run any of your app. Now, any of the app which I mean by which I mean is it could be a .NET app, it could be a Java, it could be Python, Ruby. So any app, you have a platform available. You don't really need to worry about the platform. Another piece is identity. This is actually gaining a lot of interest in the open market, because when we talk about cloud, identity is one of the key aspects to it. As to if I'm using a lot of SaaS-based services also starting, you might be using Salesforce.com, you might be using Dropbox, you might be using, even for that matter, Google as a messaging service. You still need identity, and if you are actually open those things up, you don't want your user to actually have multiple authentication stores. You may still want to have one single, which could be your Active Directory. Now that the service is available out of cloud, right? You can leverage that. Those things can sync between each other, so your user can actually still, because what Microsoft has done is they have actually federated the same Active Directory identity with a lot of these SaaS-based applications and providers. So your same AD account can actually help you log in into Salesforce.com, can actually help you log in into your Dropbox as well. So that's the power of identity as a service available. You don't really need to set up an infrastructure for that. Right? So then the other point which we're talking about is media as a service, which Ashish was just mentioning. Media as a service is now available. So if we have a use case, and there are use cases in the industry today in every corporate, because the way things are evolving, today my communication mechanisms are getting changed. It's no more an email communication which happens or which actually excites people. They are actually now quite used to of seeing videos. So any communication should actually be in terms of a video. It could be my CEO message, it could be my HR head message, or it could even be, for that matter, training needs, right? So we built a couple of apps for some of our very large automobile players where they have actually used the same portal for training their dealer network. So they have more than 2,000 dealers across India. Imagine the power of this technology by which they are not calling anybody and everybody into one single place and giving training. They are using this app, which we have built on Azure Media Services. So all the trainings are put together in one portal, and the dealers can actually view from where they are, from whatever device they want to be, because they cannot force the devices also to those dealers, to those external entities, right? And they get the same kind of experience because the app takes care of their bandwidth issue, the device related issues, and all other related parts. We actually built some kind of intelligence also there, so that there is an analytics layer built on top of that application to all actually got trained, who all has viewed, what is the feedback, what is the kind of questions related to that, so that those things can further be tracked. And those again, business intelligence has actually been built on top of cloud as a layer. So there are intelligence BI tools available, right? So that's where we are. In terms of data services, we all understand SQL and table and NoSQL, those pieces are available. Talking about infrastructure as a service, so infrastructure as a service, if you really see, it's actually an extension of your own local, it can be an extension of your own local data center which you are. So you can simply put these services which are like in terms of VPN, in terms of the virtual network, and can then club it or link it to your set of data center which is hosted, could be on-prem or could be as a cloud provider also, right? So there's kind of a hybrid model which you can run through. Some of those scenarios where you may probably like to really, really look into cloud is, I will not take much time here, quickly store, backup, recover your data. I mean, that's the kind of low-hanging fruit which one should see over it, right? You have a humongous amount of data available with you. Why should we actually consider on-prem always as the only solution? The graph actually simply shows that's how the data grows exponentially, the exponential graph. Whereas we all understand that any kind of IO operations actually happens on my roughly working set data, which is my active data, which normally is not more than 15 or 20% of the entire data set. 15-20% is also, I'm saying, on a higher side. Now the remaining 80%, cloud could become one of the key considerable parameters to actually consider, put the data there. You can still have your active data hosted within your data center, because just to safeguard on the latency and other pieces, right, to give the user the same kind of an experience, but the remaining data can actually go on cloud. And we have a study which says that cloud storage is roughly around 4 times cheaper than your local on-prem kind of a storage. Just running it through, and then the other piece is you still have 3 copies of the data which is in cloud available. Right, the other piece which you're talking about, again, geo replication is available. So in case something goes bad in one of the key data center, the entire area goes down, you have your data safely available, 3 copies of data available in terms of a geo replication, which is there. Right, another simple one additional device which is called Store Simple. So I was talking about the active data being available on your on-prem, and the passive data can be on cloud. Now there is a device available from Microsoft themselves, there is a Store Simple, which is called Store Simple, which actually intelligently checks these pieces and can takes care of the entire cycle of the data automatically. You don't have to really do it manually. So it basically checks, there is an intelligent algorithm available, any data which is being accessed, you can set certain thresholds, any data which is accessed for 15 days, it is actually termed as a hot data, beyond that it is termed as a warm data and then a cold data. So the cold data actually moves on to the cloud and the hot data remains within your own premise, and this happens automatically. You don't have to worry about it, right? That's again is basically cloud storage being available, and an extension of your could be local storage as well.
Microsoft offers you this as a device along with the Azure encryption chips, even the environment.
Yeah, and there are various sizes available, so 4 terabyte and 10 terabyte, 16 terabyte, so based on the needs it can be further use. The second piece Nikhil mentioned in his quick remarks, development, test run your app, right? The way we are evolving, it's one of the key aspects that why should we actually do all those kind of provision that we test VMs in my own premise data center. You can actually leverage the power of the cloud, can actually push all those test VMs. When we need it, we use it. After that, we can simply shut it down. Right, and with this new offering, latest offering, Visual Studio Online is now also available, which is still the most widely used tool for your development. So Visual Studio Online is also available, which can actually hook into your entire data for your development environment piece. Right. Yeah, so this is not a 100% full-blown Visual Studio, so to say, to be honest, but you can still do a lot of things with using that Visual Studio Online as a tool. It has just got integrated with the TFS also, so you can do your configuration management also online. So you can pretty much now look cloud as your development environment or a dev lab complete with tools available there.
One feature which is coming in on the Java application or other application can be covered into .NET.
Yeah, so that's again from an open source stack point of view. There is a news which is coming in, and there is in little duration, short duration from now, even the .NET developed apps would be able to run on Linux. So that's something which is now coming in.
Very interesting.
Visual Studio also they have already released that Visual Studio 2015, which is the latest version, is going to be available on Linux as a platform. You really don't need a Windows environment to run your Visual Studio as a
tool. .NET.
Third piece is extend your network, which means pretty much extension your cloud can be an extension of your existing infrastructure or data center, which I was talking about a little earlier, right? You can have a side-to-side, point-to-point kind of a VPN connectivity between these two data centers. So cloud you can actually consider as an extended data center. They can actually be the VMs which are hosted in cloud can actually be part of your domain also. So for a user, it will be now kind of an absolute seamless experience, right? It can be part of your similar domain networks with an identity. Lastly, we all understand, right? We whatever infrastructure we may be having hosting, but we still look for some kind of, let's say, outside hosting providers to host my website. Most of us have hosted our website outside. We don't host those websites in my own data center just because we want those kind of global reach to be there. So Azure has a specific service for website which you can use, leverage, which are quick to deploy, cheaper as compared to the other offerings, I mean further cheaper I should say, and pretty easy to run and manage because it consists of all those standard CMSs which are available, Joomla, WordPress and other pieces. That's about it from an Azure standpoint. I'll take 2 more minutes. I know I'm standing in between dinner and you, but just 2 more minutes. We have a couple of very good case studies which are available, right? Which we developed for some of those. So this is one such case study which we developed for Dr. Lal Park Labs. So a lot of us actually visit Dr. Lal's center for all those diagnostics and basically tests, giving our test sample. So the application which is running in all their collection centers, where your collection details are recorded, your demography is recorded, it was actually developed by us and it runs out of Windows Azure because of the scalability need, because of the performance need, right? And it's a true example of a hybrid app actually which is running, because it is then connected to their ERP, which is Xapta, to really further process, and it is further down the line connected to the lab information management system as well. So you have a cloud app which is actually collecting data from consumers, processing all that data, and then pushing it back to, let's say, their core ERP and lab information system, pulling some data back where you also see some of those reports available on this. So this is a classic example of an app which is truly hybrid in nature, which required a lot of scalability because of a lot of increase in the business potential which they are growing with, and performance criteria. Other pieces which we delivered for another customer of ours, which is an MRO, they have built this application. I mean, we have actually built this application for them, which is again a hybrid app because it takes a lot of information from their ERP again, and it gives an access to their customers directly as to what's happening. We took an example of Internet of the Things. This is a classic example of it. These are all, and the customers are all, I mean, mostly those people who actually own private jets, right? They wanted to actually have a complete picture of what's happening to their jets. What is the service due, where it was there, what are the kind of issues which we faced during the maintenance of those jets. All that information is available to them. This app which we have created is available on their mobiles also. So Mr. Ambani and all those kind of people actually uses it to actually take, he might himself not be, but second line into him is actually using it to take care of his own private jets and stuff like that. So that's the kind of usage which this application is today having. Quick snapshot as of the application and the infrastructure what we are doing. Apart from doing cloud, so we have been traditionally a system integration which we have diversified into cloud. Cloud today being is most, I would say, major part of our revenue in terms of services revenue as well as otherwise is also. Some of those other pieces are listed down. I'll not take time.
Last but not the least, please fill up the feedback form. That's very important. Please give us very constructive feedback so that our next conference is even better than this, and we are able to really give you value for the time and effort that you have taken to.
Any query you have from the services perspective, you can write to Deepak. We will also try to reach out to you.
Thank you so much once again, and please join us for a conference.
Not by the way,
अरे कल कोई चीज़ नहीं थी यार।